The Dean Blundell Show on 102.1 The Edge may contain words or subject matter not suitable for all members of our listening audience. Listener discretion is advised.
The Dean Blundell Show. Going dick head free.
In T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 9, 6, 9. 69.
The Dean Blundell Show.
Dean Blundell and Todd. Those are the only guys that when I listen to them, I'm just howling on the way to work or school.
I've never laughed so hard in my life.
The Dean Blundell Show.
102.1. The Edge.
This is your Edge.
Damn it. Hold it.
Files with Dean Blundell on the air.
Hey, a woman wanted for DUI death in 1997 was found in Canada after she was bragging at the bar that she got away with murder.
Really?
Yeah. Cops said in 97 a then 38-year-old Jean Keating was driving wasted when she sideswiped a car, killed a 65-year-old woman, causing her cross the center, the median, and die. Yeah. She was pronounced dead at the scene. Keating, as is usually the case with wasted losers, was not hurt. She was charged then with manslaughter, DUI, reckless driving, recklessly endangering another person while awaiting trial in 98. Her attorney informed authorities he was concerned his client had flown the coop. She indeed did. Went to Winnipeg, Manitoba, where she could join every other wasted person in the world. She really loved Burton Cummings.
That's then of course, Randy Bachman.
She'd posted up there for the past 15 years doing odd jobs, apparently still a drunken biatch. She was in some bar at a hotel telling everybody she was having a smoke going,
oh, yeah, I killed a woman in 98 big time. I'm from the States.
I flew the coop.
Yeah, look it up. She says, Google it. Google it. Here's my name, Keeling. Look it up.
And you got to see the woman. It looks like she's been rode hard and put away wet. I have an idea of how she sustained her income over the past several years.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Winnipeg. Anyway, so they called the cops and they arrested her. Sure enough, brought her back to the States. She's on trial again for the crime of the century. Jesus. Speaking of shutting up, Florida County Sheriff's Office asking parents to keep an eye on their kids after people around the Phillip Park area said they saw a man watching children on the playground. They say he was even seen hiding behind trees before he walked out of the park. Deputies say the description. You should always keep an eye on your kids, folks.
Yep.
Deputies say the description they have is limited, but the guy's a white male in his 50s, 5'6", 5'7". Always a skinny little white male, isn't it?
Yeah. Terrible hider, too, apparently.
Yeah, just awful at it. Witnesses told deputies he had brownish blonde hair, receding hairline, wearing black shirt, black pants. Even more disturbing and stupid, deputies said a bunch of people overheard him saying he was there to kidnap a few kids. I'm no kidnapper. Yeah.
It's okay to wear your heart on your sleeve sometimes.
Yeah, I'm no kidnapper. Yeah. But if I'm going to kidnap some people, I'm not telling anyone about it. Especially all the kids at the park.
Yeah, I'm here to kidnap a few of you, maybe.
Somebody's getting a kidnapping.
Oh, man, are people
is weird.
Dumb.
It's dummy.
It is dumb. And, you know, if you're going to lose your mind, like if you're really going to lose your mind at the Apple store,
yeah,
there's a better place to do it. Everyone there has a camera. Portia Coleman, you know who Portia Coleman is? Really hot black actress.
Is she?
Yeah. She's at the Apple store the other day, and this lady comes in a dress with a baby in a push cart.
Okay.
What do you call those things? A pram? What do you call them?
Stroller?
Yeah.
It's been a while, eh?
Yeah, it's been a bit. She was told that if she walked into the store, apparently, she could get a part for her iPhone. Now, it you know what makes you crazy when you don't have your iPhone, right?
Oh, yeah. You just reach for something that's just not there.
Yeah. Well, this woman, in front of hundreds of people in a store in New York, this is how she acts. Once again, if you're going to have a freak out, don't do it where there are a million recording devices.
I
I was told by the Apple store I could walk in the store and get the part. Now, if anybody's been to an Apple store, that's actually not true. If you get there and there's nobody there, great. But if they're seeing people, you gotta make an appointment.
You gotta wait. Yeah. Maybe she just has no control over the volume of her voice.
You know, her husband's watching this at home when he's surfing the net at night because he doesn't want to go to bed because he just wants to pull one off so he doesn't have to go and be with her. Going, oh my God.
Every day for me.
Imagine how I feel. And Pope Francis has made a habit of making... I like this guy.
He's kind of cool.
I like him.
Yeah.
The pontiff is in Brazil to celebrate public mass. He had some lunch with bishops, afterwards riding in an open-air vehicle to catch a flight back to Rio. He made the motorcade stop, so he could get out and start kissing babies. I bet he did.
So many lines. So many things running through my mind right now.
Mm-hmm.
Warming them.
There's your Edge Files, whatever the hell day it is. Yeah. July of the year 2013.
The Edge Files.
On 102.1.
The Edge.
You're listening to the Dean Blundell Show. On 102.1, The Edge.
Said we'd never do this again, but he just won't leave us alone, so we're just going to cap it off one more time. Hey, Adrian.
Hey, Dean.
What's up? Now, I told you we couldn't come back, and I mean it, so... This is
you sure did.
Yep. Why did you call us?
You're having me back.
Why?
Well, from what I've heard, your show is nothing without me.
Yeah, okay.
From what you've heard?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah. All right. Who said that? Who told you that? Some morons on the internet?
No, some moron that I ran into at Mayhem.
Hey, moron.
He was like, hey, how come you don't call the show anymore? And I was like, Dean fired me because I was being a prick. Like, he was like, you got to get back in the show, man. We love you, man. We listen to Dean because of you, man.
No, you know what? It's funny because I told people that just when you talked about 10, 15 minutes ago, Graham emailed, he goes, please do not talk to this goof. And then Kevin emailed, he goes, it's just no, please don't, no, Adrian, no. Like, no one likes you anymore.
So?
But that's why we do the show. We do the show because we put on stuff that people like, and people don't like you anymore, so we don't have you on the air anymore.
So screw them.
No, not screw them.
If they don't like it, then that's too bad. That's their problem.
No, because if we start doing stuff that no one liked, then we'd have to go and work at Virgin.
So let them work at Virgin. Let them work at Home Depot or Starbucks.
No, listen, you're not understanding. You don't understand.
I know, I understand. No, I get you. No, I get you perfectly.
Well, if you got me, then you'd stop calling and stop emailing and leaving voicemails and weird stuff.
Well, you're missing out on a lot, Dean.
Oh, yeah? Like what?
Like my talent.
Okay. What kind of talent do you have today? What do you have for us right now?
Like that, remember that message I sent you?
Yeah, well, dumb. That was dumb.
Yeah. The singing wasn't too bad.
The singing was actually pretty good.
Yeah.
It's just your sappiness and stuff like that. No one cares.
This is it.
Because of what you put me through?
And put you through.
What did we put you through?
You started swearing and saying mean stuff, and I got
because
sick
you were
of it.
Mean to
and,
me.
And no one likes it.
Because you were mean to me.
No, I wasn't.
Sure you were. You're mean to me all the time.
Who's in charge here, me or you?
You, obviously.
So who's right? Me.
You poke fun at me because I'm different.
No, I didn't. I don't care. I don't discriminate against anybody. Everybody's the same to me. And you're not different. You're just like everybody else. In fact, I find you very funny when you're normal, but when you're not, like when you freak out and you start swearing and using bad language, I can't, and insulting our listeners, I can't put you on the radio anymore.
So what you're saying is you despise me. Despise my guts?
No, I don't despise your guts. I happen to like you a lot. I just...
We wouldn't mind it if you cleaned your guts every so often.
How come you don't return any of my emails?
Because you're done. I'm done. Yeah. I'm done. Like, you're just not on the show anymore. There's no point in talking.
I mean, for the record, if you're going to poke fun at anybody, poke fun at Bruce Jenner or one of the Kardashians. And is my last name Kardashian? No, it's a Bronte. I mean, I didn't knock up Kim Kardashian, so why do I have to suffer? I mean, I wasn't married. I'm not Chris Humphries. I'm not the one who got divorced.
Yeah, I know.
What are you talking about?
I mean, if you're going to poke fun of somebody, poke fun of Chris Humphries. Okay. Don't poke fun of me.
I'm not poking fun. No one, listen, you're doing it again. You're getting all weird. Yeah. Stop it. No one's making fun of you. No one's saying any. All I'm saying is because you go nuts all the time, I cannot put you on the radio anymore. That's all.
Well, I'm sorry. Well, I'm sorry you feel that way. But frankly, the only reason I freaked out is because I don't like when people say mean or disrespectful things to
me. Okay, like what? Give me some. So, like, let me insult you. I'll insult you, and then you tell me if that's what you don't want me to say to you.
Well, you keep assuming that I'm gay.
No, never once. No, I don't. Never have. And if you were, it wouldn't matter because I like gay people as much as I like straight people.
Okay, and well, just for the record, if I were to be friends with a gay person, it would be a lesbian. Okay? Because here's the thing. Gay men, their voices, they talk really high.
No, they don't, dude. That's a stereotype. That is a stereotype. See, you're doing it again. You're getting mad. You're going to make my homosexual LGBT, BLTs really upset.
Okay, sorry. Don't do that. Sorry.
That's better. See, now you're learning. Sorry. That's good. We can work on that.
Yeah. It's a starting point.
Look at, I'm going to start reading you some of these emails. I got a text, boo, boo, this man, Adrian, and I won't say anything else. No, get this toolbox off the phone. It's lost its charm. That's from Turner. Peter says, quote, please bust out the buzzer. Here's Josh. The three guys I carpool with and I like Adrian. Ha, ha, ha. There you go. Josh is your friend. That's nice, huh? Josh likes you.
Yeah. See, well, there's one. What about the rest?
No, not one person yet.
You sure? No. You sure didn't want me dead?
No one wants you. Don't say that. Once again, that's another thing I don't want you to talk about is death. You can't talk about that.
Sorry.
All right.
My bad.
All right. I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll keep you on hold for the morning and come back and talk to you from time to time. And people can email us and tell us if they like you or tweet us at It's Dean Blundell, at Blind Derek. If they like you, oh, this guy calls you the Prince of Penis. That's not nice,
that's
is
not,
it?
No, that's a bit, that's a little offside, too.
Yeah, because it was the Prince of Wieners, right? Not the Prince of Penis.
That's the proper name.
Right, Adrian?
Are you talking about me or Anthony Wiener?
You. Yeah,
oh, okay.
How about that Anthony Wiener guy, hey?
Yeah, I mean, better Anthony than me. I mean, I don't post pictures of my tallywanker or winky dink on the internet. So who do you think is to blame for?
Winky dink.
Winky dinky.
You're right. That's what we'll do, though. We'll just wait for people's emails and tweets. And then if there are more bad tweets than good tweets, we won't have you back.
It's like a democracy.
Yeah, exactly. We'll let the people decide. We'll put it to the people.
Oh, kind of like Survivor.
Pretty much.
Kinda.
It's kind of almost the same thing, you know? One person gets voted off the island, one person stays.
And gets right. Immunity.
Exactly. So we'll find out during the morning show. How does that sound?
Okay, sounds good, I guess.
All right. Hang on the phone.
Hopefully it's good.
All right. Winky dink. Tally-winker. See, now everybody's name. Jeff says, keep him.
Really?
Yeah. Laura, I love Adrian. Never get rid of him. He's the best.
We need a tote board.
Get this weirdo off the radio.
Nope. Strike one for the weirdo.
If open phones had a trap door, he would have fallen through it.
I'll take that as a negative.
That's from Blair.
This is the Dean Blundell Show on 102.1 The Edge.
Hey, dude.
Hey, Dean.
So... You've been calling and emailing, and just to recap, I banned you from the show because you were being just weird and stupid, and then you've been begging to come back, and I said I'd put you on the radio a little bit, and so we did today, and it was okay, but we're trying to school you and let you know you can't freak out, and the reason why we didn't have you on for a long time is because people didn't like you anymore, because you'd lose your mind.
I thought it was because I was being a dick.
No, same
thing. You were being a dick, that's why people didn't like you anymore. So I'm going to read you some of these emails that we're getting. Dean, you have to get that basement-dwelling knob-gobbling turd off the radio. Ugh, Adrian doesn't do it for me. I'll switch stations when I hear he's on. Love the show. I find Adrian annoying, but he makes me laugh, so keep him.
Hmm.
For at least all the people to hate on him. He's okay, but the whole self-pity act is annoying. Make him do Shaggy Scooby in the weather.
Ugh.
John says, I don't know what anybody's complaining about. Adrian is effing hilariously awesome. That's nice, hey?
Yeah. Go on.
Diener, I'm not a fan of Adrian. I do like the dynamic he brings to your show. You guys should get more guests like him.
Hmm.
What do you think of that one? That's from Marina.
That's good too, right?
I guess. Adrian's okay for about a minute, then I want to hammer knives into my ears. Is that good? No.
No. Nah,
that's 5-2 again so far.
Personal injury line, will you give me something? Not so much. Adrian is an effing pussy. Just hearing his voice makes me want to either punch his face or blow my brains out. Is that good?
Well, she said the P word, so... Not sure if you can say that on the radio.
No, but does that mean that person likes you or no?
No.
Yeah. The blow my brains out part was probably a...
indicator.
Keep him only if he supports Anthony Weiner texts. Hey, how about that Anthony Weiner guy?
Yeah.
Huh? What did he do?
Yeah. Took a picture of his winky dink on the internet and posted to every candidate in America.
No, just some chick.
Yeah.
Well, either way, I just hope he got some action.
No, he didn't, actually.
No.
It was all
the latest on that story, Adrian, as if you care, is that apparently he had a lot of phone sex with this one girl. And he, like, she would just start talking, and like 5 seconds into it, he'd...
It saves on long distance.
Finish. Yeah.
So he did got action.
No, he didn't got action.
But you said he had phone sex.
Yeah, but that's not action. That's your self-action. Yeah. You do that at home by yourself.
What, phone sex isn't considered getting action?
No, it's not.
No, it's the phone's an accessory.
Well, what is your definition for getting action?
Sex.
Contact.
Real, actual sex. Something you don't know about.
And mutual.
I bet I do.
No, you don't.
All right, let's move on.
I was loving Adrian. I was loving the Edge sans Adrian, and now I'm in a bad mood. Adrian's like San Francisco, has high points and low points, but he's pretty stupid all around. Is that good?
Wow.
Hell no. You think it's good?
No. San Francisco?
No, I think that... Yeah. Kick this goofball off the radio, Diener. There's another one. It's hard, dude. I don't know what to do.
People are so vague, eh?
I'm on the fence. He can be gut-busting hilarious 1 minute and then go crazy the next. Love the show. Keep up the great work. He's okay, but mostly I like the background music you guys play when he calls. You turn that up? Here.
Oh,
all of a sudden it's better. Now you're entertaining.
He's okay. 4-4 time? Nice.
You're right. She is right. The music actually makes it better.
Yeah.
All right, we'll think about it. Mostly negative, though, dude.
Mm-hmm.
Like how many negative?
8 well, to I don't know. 9 to 3, I think
yeah,
it was negative.
Yeah, that.
And how many positive?
3. That was a 3 part.
So 9 negatives out of 3 positive?
No. No. No, but you're making me laugh.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
So how many negative?
3.
3.
Three,
no, nine.
Three,
nine.
Three positive.
Oh, my gosh. Three
nine,
positive.
9 to 3. 9 negative. 3 positive. But there's like, I've got hundreds of emails I just haven't gone through. And those are just the ones that are on the front of my screen. So we'll think about it, okay?
Okay.
Hang on. Thanks for chilling out, though. I appreciate it.
Hey, no problem. You too.
This
is the Dean Blundell Show on 102.1 The Edge.
Earlier, we were talking about the Anthony Weiner scandal. I was watching CNN yesterday, and I tweeted, you know, there's nothing funnier than hearing Wolf Blitzer and all kinds of, you know, political geniuses use the word Weiner so much on TV.
Allegedly, Weiner...
And they so this guy, anyway, just to give you a recap, in case you don't know who he is, Anthony Weiner used to be a congressman, I believe a Republican congressman in New York. He gets busted for these really gross, weird, like phone sex, texting, sending pictures of his dong in his underpants to chicks, going on chat sites and having phone sex and all kinds of really neat stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So he gets busted. His wife's about 7 months pregnant. He quits. Now he's running for mayor, and more stuff is coming out. And we read some of the texts yesterday. Now pictures of this girl who was having phone sex with him. Her name is Sydney Elaine Leathers. What a great name.
Leathers.
And she looks like she decent body.
Yeah.
Face like a bucket of smashed a-holes with all the good ones picked out.
Isn't that always the way?
Oh, huh? Just bad. It was like God said, okay, I'll give you a body. And then he looked away when he was making the face.
Yeah. Someone knocked on their door.
Yeah. Well, hello. Oh, I screwed her face up.
Oh, well. I figured.
So apparently, just to give you, then we read the text yesterday. We'll read you some more later because some more came out. Her and the funny part is when he's on the news and there's a big sign. It says Weiner for mayor. Weiner for mayor. Things got real cheeky.
Oh.
His latest sexting partner. So a year after he quit, he has a baby with this girl, this wife. Her name's Emma Weiner. So no word of a lie.
Yeah,
it gets awesome. The names involved make the story entirely differently awesome. So Emma Weiner and her husband, Tony Weiner.
Yeah.
He does an article in Us Magazine basically saying the worst is behind him. 5 days before that, he was having phone sex and sexting this Sydney Elaine Leathers chick.
Yeah.
So he's just a lying dork is what he is.
He just does that whole starting now.
Yeah, and the age of 18 and you're sending Weiner shots.
Yeah.
And saying you wouldn't mind bleeping someone in the bleep, watching her bleeps wiggle while they bleep her in the face. You're an idiot.
Especially when you know what's at stake for yourself.
Yeah.
You know, go watch pornography or something else.
Yeah, the pictures stamped July 2012 have the woman showing her bum through some lingerie.
Oh.
Not a bad butt. And then, unfortunately, she shows her face.
Oh.
Weiner admitted yesterday he sexted long after he resigned from Congress in 2011. Finally said his sexting problem was over in the summer when... around the time Leathers was sending the picture of her in a thong.
Hmm.
She said Weiner was very perceived picture requests, asking her to send all sorts of naked shots, more than 30 in total. We're told Weiner has a foot fetish as well.
Sounds like it, because he kept talking about shoes.
Yeah. Asked for pictures of her feet and heels, of course. He wanted, in exchange for pictures of his
namesake.
His namesake. The relationship wasn't just online either. We're told Weiner regularly spoke to Leathers on the phone. In fact, Weiner was adamant about speaking to her because he enjoyed telling her about his sex dreams, most of which involved her.
Hmm.
Shower sex was allegedly one of his favorite topics.
Clean Weiner.
Weiner now claims the entire sexting obstacle is entirely behind him and that he's moving full steamer ahead with his mayoral campaign. This woman is not attractive at all. She looks like a bug.
Well, she was sort of built for taking doing the text pictures then.
Yeah, like the shots from behind.
Yeah.
Like the most attractive picture is the one of her foot.
Really?
Yeah. The rest of it's bad.
Yeah.
So he's got bad, like she honestly looks like
Leathers.
The north end of a southbound camel. Anyway.
But she was a willing participant too, right? So
oh, yeah.
She doesn't start coming off as the victim here.
You know what? She probably got paid for this stuff. And apparently, too, what we do know now is we know Weiner is a premature guy.
Yeah, he's a quick
finisher.
Hitter. Yeah.
as told by Nick Ritchie from thedirty.com. Have a listen to this.
In discussion that the phone sex was not good with Anthony Weiner because he would, what do you say, have his orgasm? I don't want to be crude.
No, it's fine.
Within a 30-second period. So she would never get the...
You're saying he had premature ejaculation during phone sex?
Correct.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
The gun went off a little early for him. So on top of all the embarrassing texts,
yeah,
on top of shots of his wang, on top of embarrassing his wife two times and his kid
and his career
and his city, on top of everybody knowing that he's just a massive degenerate, the gun goes off too quick.
Boom. For her.
You know, his wife can't be having a great time.
No. They went through counseling, for heaven's sakes.
Oh, no way, and it didn't work?
Didn't work.
Man, if I consider my experience, that's 0 for 2. It never works.
No, I mean, if you're already entrenched in your habits, counseling is not going to do anything.
No, but it is awesome. I mean, I love this, everything about it. I love the fact that his name's Anthony Weiner.
Yeah,
I love it says Weiner for mayor on all these signs. I love this, the fact his wife's name's Humma. I love the fact that the dog-faced chicks he's texting are sending pictures of what happened. I love the fact that we see all the texts and he's just a dirtball.
Oh, yeah.
And he talks like one, too.
Yeah. And she just gives him the one-word response. Is like, okay.
Yeah, she's bad at phone sex, too.
Yeah, she's not good.
She's bad at
sexting.
He's
doing all the work.
He really is.
You know?
Yeah, he's a pro at it, even though he comes up like... this is the thing, folks. If you're, you know, 18 to 26 and you don't have a career, a life, any promises, that kind of stuff's fine. But once you hit, like, 30, then people can use it against you. And then, on top of it all, it just becomes loserific.
Yeah, when you're young, you go, oh, he's just young. He's just sowing his oats.
Mistake when he's young. But if you're 50 like this guy is,
yeah,
you're a loser. And online. Like,
yeah.
It's not even a virtual affair. It's not even a real one. It's like a pretend. It's like having an affair with an anime cartoon.
Is something wrong with that?
No.
Oh, good.
It's the Dean Blundell Show. Head for the hills. 102.1 The Edge.
Time for Hop and Best Confession Wins. We got some Edge Fest tickets and tickets to go see the Argos. Who, by the way, Rob Ford went to the first game. Someone was sitting next to him, our mayor, 400-pound mayor.
Yeah.
And I'm starting to really like the guy. I don't know why. I mean, I've been after him for a while, but that's because of all the other stuff. The mayor stuff he does a good job at.
Yeah.
So, he was at the Argo game. Apparently, he's so big, he couldn't even cross his arms. Like, he's having a hard time crossing his arms. Someone was sitting next to him. And then someone tweeted a picture of him. I retweeted it yesterday. Of him sweating right through his suit. Did you see that?
That was kind of a hot night, as I recall,
His entire back and ass sweat looks like the Shroud of Turin.
That's gross.
And there's like, if you go to my, once again, sorry to do this, not for any other reason, just to share it with you, because, but if you go to my Twitter feed, there's a picture there of Rob Ford's back that one of my followers sent me, this guy named Uncle Laszlo, great guy. So, you can check it out, and it looks like there's a cross in the middle of his back.
Oh.
And then just sweat pouring through it at last night's Jays game.
Oh, the Jays game?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah. I put it out on Twitter that I would now like to go to an Argo game with Rob Ford. I think that would be fun.
I do, too. I think he does a good job as mayor. It's the other stuff that makes me howl. 4 more years, man.
Yeah, totally. I want to be his buddy now.
Well, I don't.
I do. I think it would be fun. Imagine the booze.
Never be, or other stuff.
Alleged.
Come on.
I don't do crack.
Yet. Time for what happened.
What happened?
Hey, what happened?
Shaner. Shane, hello? Hey.
How's it going?
Good, man. What's up?
Okay. Family reunion at the cottage, hot summer day. My parents are going to pick up the relatives. Said, Shane, you and your brother, wait here, behave yourselves, and don't get dirty. I said, okay, Dad. They take off. I say to my brother, how's about a little swim? He's like, that's a good idea. I said, but we're going to have to take our clothes off because we can't get dirty. He says, okay. So we go down to the beach. There's a giant hole that we had dug earlier because we just got a load of sand. I said, wait, why don't you jump in there? I'll bury you in. I'll see if he can get out. He says, okay. So he jumps in the hole, pour a little water in there, pack him in nice and good, butt naked. I said, I'll go get you a popsicle. He's like, no, get me out. I said, no, I'm going to get you a popsicle. I put a pail over his head, and I run up to the cottage. Right away, he starts crying. Just as I'm grabbing the popsicles, my parents show back up with the grandparents and all our relatives. And I'm like, oh, my God. Oh, my God.
So boring.
Christian.
Hello there.
What's up, brother?
Oh, not much. How you doing?
Good.
So about 7 years ago,
what
I went camping.
Happened?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, about 7 years ago, camping in the Adirondacks with my wife, a bunch of friends, and this short cross-eyed biatch, just a terrible person. Everyone hated her. It was my friends and mine responsibility to purify the water for the trip.
Uh-oh.
Oh, so, no.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Don't so we, be a cross-eyed biatch and have some water. Yeah.
Exactly. So we, big wide-mouth mason jars down to the river. And
oh, here we go. I know what you're doing with the wide-mouth thing, eh? Because so, it was the only thing big enough for your...
Big enough for my friends. So we, we completely molested it. Just like, there you go. That'll teach you. Bring it back to camp and handing out the water bottles. And my wife says, oh, there's my water bottle. The one we had molested and starts drinking.
But it was meant for the other girl.
Exactly. I didn't realize it was not my wife's. And so she drank it. Me and my friend are sitting there going, oh my God. And the worst part is that 7 years later, the Nalgene bottle's still in my cupboard at home. So every time I open the cupboard, I think to myself, my wife has had her mouth basically on my...
Yeah, I know.
That ain't proper.
Don't wet mess with people's food. I don't need to...
You told the story very well, though.
Yeah. Hey, Ben.
Hey.
What's up, dude?
Hanging out. How are you?
Good.
What happened?
What the f*** happened?
Hey, what happened?
So I'm walking down the train tracks, and I smell...
Why?
Why?
Do you work there?
Yes.
Oh, you work for the railway?
Oh.
Yes.
Okay.
So... have you ever smelled the gunk in stretched ears? It kind of smells like the worst thing you've ever smelled in your life.
Oh, like toe jam or belly button lint?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mixed with poo.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
I smell that.
Wow.
I'm like, what is this smell? And I look in the bush, and there's a guy kneeling down. He's dead.
Oh. He's kneeling down and he's dead?
Yeah, he's hanging.
Oh.
Oh,
dear.
What's even worse is there is a cat sitting on his shoulder, picking at him.
Oh. You saw a cat eating a dead guy?
With a collar on.
Oh, imagine if he licked his owner's face later.
And then it ran off and went into a residential area.
That's
and
gross.
And that is why... I do not like cats anymore.
The moral of the story, keep the cats in the kennel.
Brandon.
How's it going, man?
Good, bud. What's shaking?
Nothing much.
What happened?
Hey, what happened?
All right, so I was living in Sudbury for a year. They're going to school, and there's a lot of theft and stealing from other townhouses. And... one night around the end of the year, I got myself some ice cream, something I hadn't had all year. And me and my buddies were all drunk, and I decided, let's have some ice cream. So I went to get it, and it was gone. Someone took it. Oh. So for some reason, I knew exactly who had it. Went a few doors down, kicked in their front door, grabbed it out of their freezer, brought it back to my house, ate a bit of it, and then got my buddy to completely take a nice steamy piss in it, pass it around, horked a couple of frothy loogies in it, mixed it all up, and then I walked back and put it in their freezer again. And then about a week later, I went on my porch to have a smoke, and I seen Buddy there sitting there eating it.
Oh, man, come on.
Okay, we don't...
condone this.
No, but that's funny. Zach.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
What's up, dude?
Not much. All right, I saved my buddy's nut from exploding one time. He called me really early in the morning. I think we were both around 16. He's my best friend. And he's like, dude, don't laugh at me. Something's wrong with my nut. It's huge. I don't know what to do. And I said, oh, sorry. I know what it is, buddy. My mom is a nurse, so she's always telling me horror stories. And I knew what it was. So I got my mom's Toyota Echo, and I punch it like 120, 130 through this 50 zone, right?
Whoa.
So I'm like, oh, buddy, I'll be damned if I lose a nut on my watch. So I'm just driving down the street. And I'm like, if a cop sees me, I don't even care. I'm just going. And yeah. Sure enough, there's a cop right there. And he comes flying out after me. So I'm not stopping. I'm going through this subdivision. I'm going like 120. I'm going trying to take corners at like 80 in a Toyota Echo. And this guy's just tailing me. He's just chasing me. I finally make it to his little housing project he's living in, this little ghetto subdivision. And the cop comes squealing in behind me and pulls up behind me. And I get out and he's screaming, get in your car! And just then, my friend comes walking out like he's holding a basketball between his legs, and he's hunched right over, and he's just screaming and flailing his arms and legs, and his brother's trying to help him out, and the cop's looking at me like he's going to have paperwork coming out of the demon hole if he screws around with a 16-year-old kid going that fast to save his friend's grapefruit nut. So anyway, he's like, oh, okay, just try to slow it down, and he gets back in his car and drives off, so... I was like, all right, so I punch it again to the hospital. I'm flying through the subdivision, and I had to pretty much drag him in the front doors at the emergency room, and he's like, I've never seen someone in pain like this before. He's just, his arms and legs are just...
So, yeah, but when you got him into emerge, did they save his nut?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Because people throw a scene, right, and they want to make sure it's for real. But he sat down, and I'm panicking because security's looking at us because he's, like, swearing and pushing chairs, and he's just, like, his arms are just flailing uncontrollably. Yeah. And I was looking at the nurse. I was like, hey, you got to do something. Like, he's going to lose his mind here. And sure enough, they just pumped him full of morphine, dragged him in the back, and the doctor just grabbed his nut and just flipped it with his hand, and it just all let go instantly.
Wow, that doctor's good with nuts right there. You are a great...
Yeah.
You're the winner. You saved your buddy's nutsack.
Yeah. Right on.
Yeah. How did you feel? You feel like a hero?
All the time. Whenever I owe money or something, I'm like, hey, buddy, you owe me a nut. He's like, just get old, man. Come on.
No, he owes you for life. You should never pay for beer with that guy again. You saved his nutsack. Congratulations.
The Dean Blundell Show.
I have some bad things to say about those people. Freaking, I heard it. Flying through my freaking damn wall.
The Dean Blundell Show.
Boom, man.
102.1.
Freaking, I knew it.
The Edge.
Jeff Wells is here, divorce lawyer.
Hey. Yes.
doing something divorce lawyers never do. Gives out free advice on, the odd Wednesday or Thursday. Great to see you. How are you?
Great, great. I'm just back from vacation.
So yeah, you look really well rested.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Like I don't want to talk about my hair or my good looks today.
Yeah, no kidding. It's just nothing. But see, we were talking about it earlier. If I was a divorce lawyer, because you represent men and women.
I do.
And I've heard stories, not from you, but from other people, about women approaching their divorce lawyer to pay off a bill in interesting ways, or, you know, hey, I'm getting divorced, I need to latch on to something else. You know, a good-looking divorce lawyer, much like yourself, I imagine it would be tough. Have you heard any story?
That costs extra.
Oh!
No, I'm just joking, of course. A lovely client gave me a painting.
Oh, week. You're kidding.
Yes, a very nice painting.
That's it?
That's it.
Well,
what was the painting of?
Abstract impressionism.
It was. Oh, I thought it was you naked.
Yeah,
this is how I imagine you.
No. This is a picture I painted of you at my house, in my basement, tied up to the furnace.
I call it peekaboo.
Anyway, nice to see you. Ready to take some phone calls?
I am.
People need your help, Jeffrey. Hi, The Edge. Hello.
Hi. How are you?
Good. What's your name?
Roxana.
Roxana, question for Jeff Wells, please.
Hi, Jeff.
Hello.
I was just wondering if two people have custody of their child and one wants to move a little bit further away, how would that work?
Well, how much further away?
let's say, from Montreal or Ottawa or something like that.
To Toronto?
Yes.
Is it a joint custody arrangement where, you know, both parents parent the child equally, or some sort of fixed schedule?
Yeah, give us your too vague. Give us your deal. So, are you married to a dude? You're divorced, and you got two kids, one kid?
I have two kids.
And they joint custody 50-50?
That's right.
Okay, so where do you both live now?
Montreal.
And are you in Montreal right now?
No.
Oh. So you both live in Montreal. But he wants to move to Toronto, or you want to move to Toronto?
He wants to move to Toronto.
He wants to move to Toronto. So in that case, Jeff, tell her what's going to happen. You have to agree to it, obviously, and he would have to give up certain days, I guess. Is that correct?
Well, in that sort of relationship, I don't think anybody's moving.
No?
Oh, really?
I'm assuming you're opposed to moving, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so I don't understand. The reason for the move is not so much important. It's what's in the best interest of the child.
Right, but what if it was work-related?
Like, what if you got transferred and there's no other place for
me?
You'd have to. Yeah, okay.
Well, then he makes a personal decision whether to pursue his career or stay in Montreal and parent a son.
Ooh. Oh, okay. Ooh, that's suck. That's a toughie. You just gave them the bitch slap of truth right there, Jeff.
Yeah.
Boom. Yeah. So he's got to make a decision. He's got to decide to stay, or he's got to decide to go.
Right. Okay.
And then in that case, if let's say he does go, let's say he's like, you know, hey, I got to go check this out and see what's going on in Toronto. So he goes here. He would have to give up 50% custody and arrange days when he could come back. However, he keeps his 50% access, so he can come and see him anytime.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what sort of agreement you have in Quebec, and I'm an Ontario lawyer, so I would caution you. I mean,
unless you want to move too.
No, that won't be happening.
Oh.
No.
Yeah.
You like Montreal?
I do.
Montreal chicks are wicked. They do things Ontario chicks don't.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I should stay in Montreal.
They don't turn on reds.
Like, I should totally stay in Montreal. Those chicks do crazy stuff. Hi, The Edge.
Hello.
Hey, man. What's your name?
Brian.
Question for Jeff.
I've been separated for 7 years. I have a separation agreement. The ex and I are finally ready to do the divorce. She wants to contest the divorce. I'm wondering if she can get any more money out of me, given that I make more money. She's getting a little bitter. Wondering financially whether I should have any concerns other than, legal bills.
Does the separation agreement contain a spousal support release?
Yes.
All right. Well, that's a non-starter. So what's she going to contest?
I don't know. She's claimed she's contesting it.
Well, you don't have a question, really, then.
Yeah, she's an idiot. There's your answer. your ex-wife's an idiot. You got nothing to worry about. Is that a pretty good answer?
Yes.
Yeah.
I agree.
She might as well say, hey, do you want to come with me and walk on the moon? Because that's not happening either. On the Edge. Hello. Hey, question for Jeff.
Yeah, I just wanted to know, I'm a single guy, and I have a house and a business. If I hooked up with some chick and she moved in and wanted to get married and everything else, once I get married, is she entitled to half of everything, like the house and the business and everything?
It becomes a matrimonial home, and she has, that's included in the union, the calculation of your net family property. I'll call the pie. I don't want to use it too many legal words here.
Yeah, use the word the pie. That's included in your
but
pie,
your business,
sir.
You will get the value of your business will be, you will only share in the increased value of your business. And then if you do something stupid, like issue her shares, then, you know, you are screwed.
If you do something stupid like include her in all aspects of your life, you're poached.
Yeah. But if you're already planning the divorce, you haven't even gotten married yet. There's a problem there.
Get a vasectomy.
Yeah.
That's all single males should get a vasectomy.
Oh, absolutely. Chop the thing right off.
This is what guys ask, though. This is the most asked question from dudes is, what's the deal? Like, if I've already established myself, I am thinking of getting married. And I hear all these crazy stories. How do I protect myself? And that's a relationship contract or a marriage contract, right?
Yes, absolutely.
It's not called a prenup anymore, is it?
No, it's, I mean, if you're not married, it's a domestic contract or cohabitation agreement.
Mm.
I got a call yesterday about somebody who's getting married on Saturday. Asked me if I could give them legal advice on their marriage contract.
And what'd you say?
I said, buzz off.
Why?
Why? Because you know, 3 years or 4 years down the road when they separate and all hell's breaking loose and they look at who was the lawyer who advised her on the contract. It's going to say Jeffrey Wells. And they say, well, she basically signed this on the church steps.
Yeah.
Or under the hoopoe.
Under duress.
I don't know. Yes. Yeah, so.
She was forced to sign it because it was like a last second thing.
Yeah.
So you got to pre-plan that stuff.
Yeah.
Yes, you have to be very deliberate in your actions.
And both people have to completely agree to it. You can't just force someone to sign it on the wedding steps of your...
And attempt to get away with it, no.
That's like
ultimate... That's a sweet move, though.
Cold feet, ultimate cold feet right there.
Have you heard of that? Yeah, have you heard of someone like, you know, hey, listen, I know we're getting married tomorrow, but if you don't sign this, I'm not showing up. Have you heard of those?
That happened all the time.
Are you serious?
Come into our office like, I'm screwed, right? And it's like, you get nothing, no property rights, no spousal rights. I guess it's a good way to keep a marriage together.
I mean, to shoot for.
You're screwed. I better stay.
I guess I gotta stay.
Heidi Edge, Dave in Burlington.
Hey boys, how you doing?
What's up, brother?
Listen, I got my brother married a fire-breathing dragon. She flies around the room, setting the drapes on fire, and I wanted to know.
Explain. I want stories. Yeah. Fire-breathing dragon doesn't count when it comes to something in the courtroom. That doesn't wash. Well, sir, she's a fire-breathing dragon.
Look at her.
Well, that's just how we like to refer to her around the house. But he wants out of the marriage.
Is she bitchy?
Oh God, yeah.
Give me an example. What does she do? Does she keep the man down?
Well, she won't allow him to see any of his family.
That's not one of them. Nice.
That's so nice. Now I'm on the phone.
Yeah.
So he went to see a lawyer. He said that given the fact that he has three children under the age of six, and case law in Ontario, he's got no chance of getting 50% custody of the children.
That's a lie.
So he needs a different lawyer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a lie, isn't it? Like, this is the thing, is that everybody doubt, and I've gone through it, and I'm still going through it, and I can tell you this, is that if you're a decent human being and you love your kids, and everybody knows that, it doesn't matter. Unless your wife plays dirty pool, unless your spouse plays dirty pool, you're entitled to 50% access, 50% custody of your kids, right? Having them half right. the time.
Now, does it make any difference?
No, hang on.
There's no presumption that you're entitled to 50% access. There's no presumption that you're entitled to joint custody.
But what if he's a great guy and a good dad? Why can't he have him half the time? Would he have to prove that?
Three kids under six?
Yeah.
He wants them half the time.
Are you asking my personal opinion or what the court's going to do?
Both.
Well, my personal opinion, there should be a presumption of joint custody.
Yeah.
Right? And you should get away with the idiotic debates about sole or joint.
Yep.
But when you have three kids under six, what are the ages of the kids?
Six, three, and one.
Okay, so 50-50 is not appropriate for a one-year-old.
No, got to be
one. You will hear that. Yeah. You will hear that across the land, perhaps in even Croatia.
Well, that's pretty well off. So I mean, they've got a nanny that they can share that can go in between houses, so there's some consistency there.
Does he have a ton of dough?
She makes double what he makes.
Oh. Well, the other thing is you could say, no problem with the custody. Give me half your stuff and it's party time.
If I was your brother, yeah. I would, you know, have some sort of third party professional mediator come up with a parenting plan that has graduated staged access so he can get the shared parenting when the youngest one is in school full time.
Because he's probably not a good breastfeeder.
Yeah. But that's an issue. No, I mean, you should...
Neither is she.
Neither is she. Oh, so you're so the younger it does matter. I guess the younger your kids are, you know who the kids are with.
Yeah.
But what if she's? It sounds like she's an unstable. So does it play into it at all?
She said that if he plans on divorcing her, that he's never going to see the kids. That's her stance.
That's dumb.
That is a ominous statement. And he's still living in the house with her?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's still there. He's putting up with it.
Bet you that dinner's uncomfortable most nights, eh?
Yeah.
Well, she doesn't cook for him. She buys food for her and the children and gets mad if he takes an apple.
Are you serious?
Oh, she is a dragon.
She'll buy seven apples for the kids throughout the week, and if he takes one, he gets in trouble.
Jeez.
I thought I was kidding about the fire-breathing dragon stuff.
No, I'm starting to understand.
Jesus Christ. Are you will she let him watch TV or go out and hang out with his friends?
Well, he's been fishing in another pond for the past couple of years because he's been fed up, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
Hmm. And so she's caught him?
Does that play into any custody issue?
No.
No.
Okay. No, he can pork whatever he wants.
We have no fault divorce, and unless your conduct is relevant to your ability to care for your kids, it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Tell him to get a good lawyer, though.
Get a mediator,
get a lawyer, and tell him all the stuff. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Thanks, brother.
All right, dude. Take care. Well, Jeffrey, I like what we've done today.
That was interesting.
We've caused probably 3 divorces and several separations. <Yeah. Not bad. laughs> Jeff Wells, G Wells, MPLLP.com. Is that correct?
Yes.
G Wells@MPLLP.com?
Yes.
Wells Family Law on Twitter. If you have any questions, really appreciate you coming and thank you very much. And you'll be back in a couple of weeks, but keep it on the straight and narrow and take it easy.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed it.
No, you didn't.
This is the Dean Blundell Show. 102.1.
Yes. Here's a fellow we haven't had on the air for a long time. Adam Giambroni, everybody.
Hey.
What a good guy.
Good to be here.
Yeah, it's nice to see you again. You look exactly the same. You still look like you're 14.
Well, last time you said I looked 12, so at least I've aged a little
bit. Okay, 2 years. Yeah, well, it's been 6 years.
You're
an adolescent since we've seen you, so yeah, that'd be 14.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're like a Highlander.
I mean, hey, look, if I can say that in another 30 years, I'll be pretty happy.
Well, what have you been doing? We were just talking. You know the Miller era ends.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that in a second, and then you take off and you go work somewhere, and you've been running around.
Yeah, well, I've actually been building transit and subways and stuff in other cities. So Montreal, I've worked for Montreal. I've done some work for Milwaukee.
Yeah.
Where they actually want to be, where they're serious about it, they get some money. And then they actually build transit instead of just bouncing
sitting around talking about it
and bouncing back and forth across the wall and throwing hundreds of millions of dollars down the tube.
So you watch this whole transit stuff, and I don't want to get into the details of it because it's super ass boring. But and you know that too, yeah, right?
Bingo. And actually, people just want to see what's going to actually get built instead of just talking about it.
Yeah. So it's the subways or the light rail or the hang gliders or like elephants, whatever it
swan
is.
Swan boats.
Yeah.
I'd take those.
Yeah, me too. That sounded like it'd be relaxing. Very relaxing on the way
works
downtown.
On Center Island. You
know? Does it really?
Yeah,
they do swan boats on the island.
Yeah, but they kind of just go around and around in circles. You know?
Well, that's not feasible, Adam. I don't know why Milwaukee's taking your word for it. Swan boats. So you've been building transit. And now you've decided to jump back into politics, and the politics is you're running for a by-election in the Scarborough-Gilwood area.
Bingo, yeah.
Against who? Who are you running against?
Well, there's 7 different candidates, so we've got everyone from the Libertarian.
Not those guys. Oh. I mean, like, real, like, the real threats. You, someone else, and someone else.
Yeah, I mean, so basically, I mean, they're, with no disrespect to all the 7 people there.
The Libertarians
there,
and the...
There's the Libertarians, there's the Disability Rights
Marijuana.
Party running. I don't think the Marijuana Party is actually nominated there, although, you know, perhaps,
it's Scarborough.
Well, maybe they didn't get their stuff together. Would that surprise you about the marijuana party?
Late.
But
that makes room for the crack party. Yeah.
But you know, but look, there are of course the Liberals and the Conservatives, and it's Mitzi Hunter running for the Liberals and Ken Krupa who's running for the Tories.
Mitzi, what a great name! I wouldn't vote for someone named Mitzi just out of principle. Okay, so you're now getting into federal politics or municipal? What do you call that again?
Provincial.
That's the one. And you want to be an MPP.
Yeah.
And you know this comes with a price tag, obviously, right?
Well, absolutely.
Like the scrutiny of your personal life and all that other crap, and you're okay. You're standing there, right?
You
now.
Know, I mean, people come up to me and talk a little bit about it because they know me. They've known me on transit. They read the newspapers. They hear about things, mm-hmm. and mostly they just want to talk. They want to actually talk about what I'm going to do, what I'm going to actually deliver in Scarborough.
Well, and it's interesting now because and you're you know the one thing about you, and I've always said it is every time you come here, you talk honestly, you're open, you're open to discussion, and you understand you're a city councilor for a very long time and a very young city councilor. You were like 12 when you got in.
That's right. Yep. We changed the laws here to make it legal so
they
I
did.
Could run.
Everybody's having coffee. He's having chocolate milk and Twinkies for snack, much like Rob Ford, actually. So anyway, you leave office. There's a scandal because you had a relationship with someone that you worked with at City Hall, and that just turned into a big nightmare for you.
So actually, I never just a quick point. They never were at City Hall, but I did have a relationship, and that you know it was difficult. I mean, you go through these things, and you know we all make mistakes.
Absolutely.
And sure. When the difficult thing about being in the public eye
sure.
is, of course, you live these mistakes out in front of everyone. Mm-hmm. The nice nice thing about it, though, is that actually people are pretty understanding. They expect if someone makes a mistake, if you go about and learn something.
Oh, the difference between you and probably half the other people there that did that job is that, you know, someone ratted on you. That's the only difference.
Yeah.
Other people's, you know, I can guarantee you, and I know this for an absolute fact, mm-hmm. and I'm standing here saying it, actually sitting, but, you know, there's lots of that going on there. There has been for years and always will be. That's just the nature of the beast. But
look, I'm just glad I did it when I was young. I mean, you end
got
up...
Got it out of your system?
Well, you get out of your system. You end up learning something.
It's grosser.
when you're older?
When you're older.
Yeah, because just imagining Doug Holliday being involved in a story like that. The visual's disgusting.
Yeah, I'm not really sure I want to go there.
Yeah, no, me neither. So then after that happens, you and your girlfriend, or was it your fiance at the time?
No, she was a girlfriend.
Girlfriend, yeah. You guys... she says, you were in trouble. We are going to France. And then you went on vacation and you worked everything out?
Well, it was difficult. I mean, it wasn't, you don't work one of these things out in a couple of days. We took about a year and a half and, you know, you talk about a lot of things. You think about where you're going to go, what you want in life. And then about a year and a half, almost 2 years after, we ended up, I proposed and we got married.
So you're married now?
We're married. I'm married as of about 18 months ago.
Good for you.
Congratulations. And it's going well.
She must have your nuts in a handbag.
Yeah. Well, she's an amazing woman, and so that's,
well said.
I'm pretty lucky, and she put up with a lot, and you know it's actually,
does she get a gimme now too? Like does she get like? Because if it were me and I were her, I would have said, you know, I'm gonna do something. You are never gonna find out when or where or how.
She's got a pass.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, look, I owe her a lot. She's gone through a lot, but not just, you know, being married to someone who's in the public eye. I mean, you go through a lot of scrutiny.
Because this is going to come up, right? And this is kind of the best place to talk about it because it's very pedestrian here. You know, this is an everyday thing. There are millions of people that do, whether it's with someone else that you do something stupid or on your own. I mean, stupid is stupid, whatever the qualification is. And we're all young at some point in time and stuff happens. But, you know, this is the best because it's going to come up and talk about it. How are you going to deal with it when people ask you?
You know, one of the easier things is when you go through something like this as public as it was.
Sure.
You have an opportunity then, you know, you can talk about it. People come up because there's nothing really secret here, right? Yeah. I mean, if you had something that you wanted to keep secret and not tell anyone, then it might be an issue. But in this case, you know, people know. And so they come up and they've been there, maybe not exactly in those circumstances, but as you said, people have made mistakes. They sort of understand and I think they expect, and you know, some of the old grandmothers come up to me and say things. Well, I hope, and I had a woman just the other day, I'm going to vote for you as long as you tell me you've learned your lesson. And that's, you know, and that's a fair...
Yeah, the reconciliation is just as public. Yeah.
All right, Mabel.
But you know, I mean, this woman was, you know, 65, 70. She's, and then, I mean, it actually happens quite a bit. People have said that.
Was she hot?
Well, she's... For 65, hey, I say, if I look as good as she does at 65, I'm going to be lucky.
Yeah. Well, and you know what? And that's the thing is that, you know, people make mistakes and stuff happens. But at the heart of it, you know, you're an experienced, smart, young, vibrant, energetic man that back when you were on city council represented your people very well, represented your vision very well, and that put Toronto basically on the precipice for the current situation to then drill that into the ground. So, you know,
you're talking about subways.
Yeah, I'm talking about everything. It's just a huge mess. But anyway, it's nice that you're back into it and you're watching this. So let me get your impression. Anthony Weiner, then. Let's talk about this Anthony Weiner guy running for Weiner for mayor, one of the best signs I've ever seen in my life. He's going through what he's going through now, and he didn't learn his lesson, but his wife is still standing next to him.
Look, I mean, I haven't had a lot of chance to watch that because I'm out talking to people at the doorsteps in Scarborough Guildwood, but you know, the people want somebody who they can trust, and I mean, people want somebody who's learned their lesson, and I think with Anthony, maybe I'm not sure I'm going to give him advice, but I will say that people actually want somebody who are going to deliver results. I mean, they you know, they talk when they come to me, and I told you about this one grandmother, but then they want to say, okay, but now I want to talk to you about what you're going to do here and how you're going to deliver and what you're going to do for us. And then that's because that's what it's about, actually delivering results. You know, in this case, I'm not going to change the whole government. I'm one of 108, but you know, I've got to get there and make sure the Liberals deliver on actually building subways and rapid transit in Scarborough instead of just talking about it, because that's all they seem to do.
Yeah. Adam Giambroni, our guest running for NDP Scarborough Guildwood, really appreciate you coming in. Thank you very much. Always great to have you. And when's the by-election?
August 1st.
August. Oh, so it's coming up.
Oh, yeah. It's a week from today, in fact.
Oh, August 1st. He's a good man, and should I live in that area and want to vote in a by-election, I would vote for you only because I know you and you're a quality individual above all things. So thank you very much for coming by.
I look forward to being back.
Where are you on Twitter?
I'm Adam_Giambroni.
Adam_Giambroni. Check him out there. Really appreciate you coming in. Thanks so much for your time.
This is your Edge.
Got it. Hold it.
Files with Dean Blundell on the Edge.
Cleaning crew got a nasty surprise when they walked into an Atlanta bar this morning and found a dead dude hanging from an outside security fence. It's a weird one. The crew arrived at Moondogs around 7:30. What a name. When they found a dude's body, Atlanta police believe he was attempting to rob the bar when he climbed over a fence. There's only clearance of 6 or 7 inches between the top of the fence and the ceiling of the patio, and it seems the man's head got stuck in there as he was trying to squeeze his whole body through there.
Oh. Ooh. He almost made it.
Ooh. It appears he got hung up on his neck, and that's why he is asphyxiated. Oh. I hate saying that word.
Yeah. Asphyxiated.
Exact cause of death is pending his autopsy. This isn't the first time this has happened. It happened last year when a guy named Edward Robert Powell hung himself, broken into someone's house on the drapes.
On the drapes?
Yeah. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Imagine having your head stuck in there and not being able to get out, though. That I would know. Suck. Remember that story, the lady from the Tim Hortons? There was a dude from the Tim Hortons, dropped a quarter, the old fella. It was just in Chatham.
Yeah.
And then...
when he's in the drive-thru?
And then he opened the door to pick up the quarter, yeah. And then the car moved forward and sandwiched his head between that yellow caution pole and his car.
Didn't put it in neutral.
Didn't get the quarter. Are we really doing this? Suicide bombers using donkeys again?
Leave them alone.
The donkeys and the disabled people alone over there. Send your brother. Send someone, you know.
It's slim pickings, I think. That's the problem.
They must be running out of suicide bombers, yeah. NATO's International Security Assistance Force confirmed Tuesday 3 casualties in a bombing in Afghanistan. Only provided small details, but they did say a donkey walked into an area, a hotbed of Taliban insurgency. The donkey then walked into the area of where, I know it's terrible because people pass away.
Of course it is.
But the donkey saunters in there wearing one of them vests. And a blanket over top of the vest. Apparently, some people around said there were wires coming out of its backside.
Right.
And kaboom.
Clue
they blow the
one.
Thing up. 4 Afghan soldiers in the convoy were wounded as well as an interpreter. Look at the donkeys. Come on.
Like, they don't even know what they're doing.
No. They're the dumbest animals in the world. That is so unfair. You know what they should do? See if you can get one on a lion.
Oh, yeah.
Nobody F's with a lion, man. Nobody. And a nursing home resident in England out feeding the seagulls with her boyfriend. Old lady with her boyfriend. Mm. Sounds like a fun thing to do. lost her dentures when one of the birds swooped in and took it off her.
Ew.
Renee Abear was having a cup of coffee, tossing scraps of bread to the birds. One of them decided it needed a little more and went and grabbed her dentures that she had put down on the picnic table. Staff members at the nursing home searched the grounds and only found one of the top of the dentures on the roof.
Oh, okay.
She said she had complained to one of the nursing home workers that she was very upset because she just got the new dentures and she didn't want her new boyfriend, also from the home, to see her without them.
Oh, contraire.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I think he was hoping there were dentures.
Well, listen, that's the luckiest thing to ever happen to me.
There's a seagull with a giant smile sitting up on the top.
Get those gummers over here, love. Let's now give those a quick ride glider. Now the obstacles are out of the way. I'm going to change your name from Mildred to Smooth Ride.
That was your Edgefiles for the hell day. It is in July of the year 2013.
Yeah! The Edge! Edgefiles
on 102.1
The Edge.
Bored? Lonely? Hard up. Use your free hand and follow the boys on Twitter.
At Dean Blundell Show.
The Dean Blundell Show. 102.1
The Edge.
Sam does. What's up?
Hey, guys. My wife is steadily trying to convince me that sex almost once a month is in the normal range of a young family household. And I'm coming across as an oversexed teenager if I want it more.
Okay, so I love that. This is sort of like how I used to tell my ex-wife a round of golf was 12 hours long. It is. It's 12 hours. You know, that first of all, there is no such thing as normal when it comes to sex unless it's just completely weird. But it's as much or as little as you want to have it. It sounds like she doesn't want to have it, so it sounds like she's got a problem. You want to have it all the time still. How old is your family?
Our kids are 6 and 4. We're in our late 30s.
Yeah, okay. And
I'm healthy. I'm not.
Does she
I don't
like?
Think I'm totally horny.
Does she like doing it?
When she gets going, I think she has a good time.
Does she have a job?
Yep.
Is she real busy?
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, that'll do it.
Make some time. Are you busy?
Not as busy as her, but
yeah.
I'm never too busy. Oh. You know what I mean?
Well, I know that, but you know, it's sometimes it takes a little more to convince her that more is better. She's just busy and probably, you know, you got to understand where she's coming from too. This is what guys understand. I want more sex. You're not giving it to me. Someone go find it somewhere else. No. You know, do you like her?
Yeah, everything else is fantastic. It's this is one thing.
Yeah, and it's a big one. It's like 50-60% of your relationship is the sex.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's with everybody. If someone usually says it sucks, the relationship sucks, you can start with the sex life and work your way out from there.
Yeah.
But in my estimation, she's busy, you're busy, you're not as busy as her. It matters more to you than it does to her right now. But make her feel cool, dude. Make her feel dangerous. Take her somewhere cool. Do something. Like, plan something. Be spontaneous.
Listen, I've been at this for a good 7-8 years, and I do those things, and I'm doing some math, and basically, it cost me a G to get laid, you know, to do something special.
Clearly, you're looking at it right.
Yeah.
Clearly, you have great intentions.
Thinking with your heart there.
Yeah, way to go, man.
I don't have $4,000 a month, you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I understand. But it doesn't take money to do that. Like, when was the last time you made dinner for her and shipped the kids off for a couple days?
Oh, this is why I'm calling. I had a spectacular weekend with her. She was the princess all weekend, and then Sunday night she fell asleep, and I almost jumped out of the window.
Oh, yeah. What spectacular weekend? What did you do?
It was her birthday, so she had a party. We had her friends over, took her out.
Did you get wasted?
She did. I drove. Yeah. Everything was great. You know,
is she going out a lot?
No, we never go out.
Does she go out with her girlfriends all the time?
Never.
She ever come back late at night if she does?
That's one thing I don't have to worry about.
Yeah, okay.
I think overall she's not interested in it.
Yeah, maybe she's just, it's not you, it's just she's not interested in sex. You know what
That's
I mean?
A tough one.
Maybe,
That's
are, a tough are you bad in bed? Do you know what you're doing?
I make sure she's good before I even start.
Are you making an effort? Oh, okay, good.
Ah, that's nice.
Yeah, maybe it's just her.
Maybe that's all she needs.
Yeah. Maybe that's the problem.
Yeah.
She knows what she gets, and she gets it real quick. Just keep doing your thing.
4 minutes of heaven.
Four. It's a long time. 4 minutes of heaven. Hi, The Edge.
Hello.
Hey, Mike. How you doing?
Hey, how's it going, Dana?
Good, dude.
I don't remember me. I used to be doing valet there. We've seen Drake a few times.
Yeah. Drake's valet, dude.
But he just got a Bugatti, eh?
Bukaki what?
He bought a Bugatti. The car. It said started on the license.
It said started?
Yeah, started on his license.
It does it really. That's just the license
really?
On his Bukaki says.
Yeah, he's too many Bukakis on the car. Anyway, I got a little problem here. A good buddy of mine's pulling an old Rob Ford special. He's been smoking a lot of crack lately, and he's been showing up to people's places and like getting money from them, like saying, "Ah, I got some LCD TVs for you and this and that." And people are giving him money, and he's showing up in like random places to people I know, like coworkers and stuff, and like begging for money and stuff. I don't know what to do with this guy.
You know what? That's the easiest one to answer. Is you got to get a whole group of your friends. You got to slide tackle them, tape them up, yeah, and take them in for rehab.
Yep. This guy's like some of the moves and things he said to get money.
No, you don't have a choice. You got to grab. You got to grab this crackhead and corral him and take him in for treatment. That's the only thing you have to do.
Like, you know what the thing is, Dean? I smoke weed myself. Like, I'm not the most perfect guy either. So it's like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm gonna have an intervention when half my friends smoke weed and do it.
It's different though, dude. Like, you guys function. You might smoke dope at night or whatever, but you guys function, and I don't condone any of it, nor do I promote it. But I'm saying it's awesome. No, but like,
and another reason, he sold his phone for $100, so that's another reason why it's hard to get a hold of him.
Well, when you see him, you need to grab him. It's like a fish, man. When you see him, grab him, and then you got to take him in and do something, like call, you know, his parents, you know, his friends, because, you know, like crack and all that other garbage. That's a terrible, terrible door to go through.
His mom's like an older woman, so it's hard for her to, like, you know, I talked to her and it's like,
well, you know what? The only thing I could say is if it's important to you, you'll help him. If not, you won't. You'll be able to deal with it. If not, you can't.
But addicts are very creative, eh? When they need to get money.
Oh yeah.
Oh, they delve into their creativity.
Yeah, I know a dude that was addicted to coke.
Yeah.
And he would, you know, one of the straightest guys ever. He would go and turn tricks at the bus station.
Really?
With men. Yeah.
With fellas?
Yeah. He would just go down there and was like, hey, I need some coke, and some guys were like, hey, I got some, or some guy was like, yeah, I'll give you some money, but you need to come into the change room, and I'll love you in your mouth.
Huh. And that was bad?
Well, yeah, I didn't. I mean, if I ever talked to him after that, I sure didn't get too close.
No, I guess not. You give him some Listerine.
Just in case. Yeah. But he's clean.
That's good.
He did all kinds of stuff. He'd go and like take odd jobs from people. This dude would take like an odd job from somebody to go and like, you know, fix a fence. And he'd go and take one board off the fence, wait for the people to leave the house, go inside, rob them, and take off and go and sell the stuff for drugs.
Wow.
Yeah. Take out an ad on Kijiji. Hey, handyman, I'll do anything around the house. Yo, sure. It'll cost you $20. I'll paint your whole fence. Pretty soon your TV's gone. And your fence isn't painted. I know, it's weird.
I know.
That crackhead said he'd paint the goddamn fence.
If he just started what he finished what he started, I didn't care if he takes the TV.
Yeah.
Okay, here you go. The Dean Blundell Show, 102.101.
The Edge.
And now the Dean Blundell Show presents
the Blunt News
with Amy Anonymous.
Yeah.
What's up, sister?
How you doing? I'm well.
Man.
I didn't have much sleep last night. I thought my
Why not?
Well, I thought my son's appendix was going to burst. He had such horrible stomach pain, so we're going to the hospital, and the kid farts, and then we go back in the house. So,
it's always gas.
I haven't had much sleep. It's been a day.
Oh, I love it when you're on your way to the hospital and appendicitis turns into a really big fart.
Yeah, and then he's like, can I have my iPad? I'm like, all right, let's go back to bed. But anyway,
wow.
There has been a lot of stuff going on in the campus.
Yeah, unfortunately,
news.
We don't have loads of time, but we said 4 minutes. You give her.
Let's do this. Okay, so first off, we have a child in our city. She is 9 months old. Her name's Caitlin. She has a rare form of epilepsy, and it's very severe. It's called Dravet syndrome. And unfortunately, we don't have CBD medicine here in Canada. So their family is petitioning the government to allow it here. It is in Colorado right now, but can only be in Colorado. Because
well, she's allowed. You're trying to get this little 9-month-old to smoke a joint?
No. This will be an edible form, and this CBD
would look really funny
down,
though.
A little bit, but I mean, it's in oil. CBD slow down seizures. I mean, this child can have up to 300 seizures a day. Could you imagine your 9-month-old child, or by the time she's 6? I mean, it's ridiculous. There's a girl right now who is in who's in Colorado. There's many kids, but one named Charlotte, who they created a strain for, Charlotte's Web, and she has been using this, and she went from a few hundred seizures a day to zero.
No way.
Wow.
So, I mean, this girl who couldn't get off her mom's lap and was listless, couldn't walk, now she's walking and moving. Come on, guys, fight this. Sign this petition for information on it. I'm going to post it all over the place later. Her name's Caitlin. It's in Toronto. It's been all over the news. But importantly now, here in Canada, today Matt Murnaugh unfortunately lost a decision for the appeal, which is absolutely
appeal
heartbreaking.
Appeal of what?
Well, 5 years ago, he was given an exemption to grow his own cannabis. Let me break it down for you. you in layman terms.
Yeah, but wasn't he growing like a whole warehouse full of it?
Yeah.
No. He was growing his own medicine. My friend Chris Goodwin, he actually broke it down in layman's terms, and I just want to read it to you because no one describes it better than Chris Goodwin
right
now.
All right.
Basically, imagine a fight with Stephen Harper and Matt Murnau that the fate of cannabis is decided. Now, the only thing is this fight happened 5 years ago, and Murnau won. He kicked his butt, knocked him right out. The judge called it a KO. But then Harper cried to the Ontario Appeal Court, and then basically they said, okay, Harper, we love you. We're going to say you're right. So today the courts made
Man, you smell like weed. It's awesome.
Yeah.
By the way. So today the courts were making a decision, and if they favored Murnau, that could have meant the end of prohibition, and unfortunately today they decided that they did not favor Matt Murnau. This is ridiculous. The Harper government is killing our country. They're making, you're going to send us all to jail. Murnau cannot access cannabis. It's a charter right to have access to safe medicine.
Yeah.
If you can't do that, there's something wrong with our gosh darn country.
Shame.
Something is wrong. Shame. Shame on you, conservative government.
Sister.
Shame on you, Harper. It's disgusting what you can do to people that you are supposed to be protecting.
Testify.
But honestly, it's absolutely ridiculous. Matt Murnau, we love you. Thank you for everything you have tried to do and you have done for us. Thousands of hours you've put into this, and the court turns it down. Harper, you suck. That's it. You suck. That's my opinion. You suck. I don't care. You suck.
So, getting back to that, then, so your kid's appendicitis turns out it was just a fart, hey?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. By the way, these views are the views of me, Amy Anonymous. They have nothing to do with the show.
No.
I think they like conservatives. I hate the conservative government.
We're in the middle.
Hate them. Yeah. I'm glad you're in the middle.
Yeah.
Vote anything. It's called ABC. Anybody but conservative.
Okay.
Never vote.
There you go.
Wow.
Thank you for finishing off our show with a flurry. Just a fart, eh?
Yeah.
Just
Part. It's the heel all.
Your viewers have given me so many
emails.
Sorry, your listeners, not viewers. Maybe one day viewers. But your listeners email me all the time. And I want to say, I get back to you as soon as possible. But if you guys really want to know anything, call me at work. I'd rather help you out that way quicker.
There you go.
Well
Amy
done.
Anonymous, everybody.
Well done,
Amy. At Amy Anonymous on Twitter. Same thing for the web. Go find you. She makes great cookies.
She really does. And maple squares.
Yeah, that sent you to the moon for 2 straight days.
Mars.
The Dean Blundell Show, 102.1 The Edge.